the next thing I have on my list here, guys, is you all requested that I read some of the trilogy for you. I think I would like to read a bit of Mechanical Failure. I've got one chapter that I've picked out. Me and my agent were like, well, what do we do? I don't want to spoil anything. What do we read? So I thought I'd read you guys a chapter in Mechanical Failure. I think it's the third... Well, it's about like a quarter of the way into the book. And let me set it up for you. Rogers gets back on his ship, which is called the Flagship. And he is put in charge. He hates robots. Like, they're hard to con, so he doesn't like them. So he really doesn't like them. And of course, he is then promoted and put in charge of an entire squadron of these brand new combat droids. And it's his first time training them. Yes, damn shinies. That's right. Soft Pretty Girl has obviously read Mechanical Failure, so you'll be familiar. So he's put in charge of this whole group of droids who are supposed to be combat. Droids have always been administrative up to this point, and now it's time for him to go in and train these droids to fight. And he absolutely doesn't want to do it, and he's absolutely not good at it. So I will go ahead and open this up. Is the volume good for you guys right now? Is the music? Should I turn the music off while we're doing this? Music is good? Okay. Great. I hope my make your stomach pains. Good. So I've got the book here. I'm actually going to read instead of looking at a screen, I'm going to read the actual words I will turn it down a little bit more. There shouldn't be that much. This should be the only screaming song. All right. I will cut the music, as a matter of fact. I'll bring it back. I'll bring it back after. So this chapter is called Big Orange Button. And if there's anything that I need to explain, I'll go as we go. In front of him, neatly arrayed in a perfect formation, was a large collection of droids, all looking like they'd just come fresh off the manufacturing belt. Their exoskeletons were clean, shimmering, and of a darker shade than the other droids, though Rogers couldn't quite put a name to the color. Their heads, horse-like, if any comparison to any animal could be made, each bore a pair of glimmering blue eyes, all of which seemed to be fixed on Rogers. In total, he counted 5 by 7 rows, making 35 shinies under his command. It was 35 too many. Shinies is his derogatory term for droids. At ease? Rogers said uncertainly. Are you all capable of being at ease? Would you melt? Nothing happened. The eerie metallic soldiers appeared no more at ease than a group of construction beams that had just been told an awful joke. Rogers wasn't even sure they'd noticed him. They stood so perfectly still that he wondered if they were even turned on. He turned to the only other human in the room, a corporal who, thankfully, responded to his command to be at ease. He was old for a corporal, which didn't bode very well for his competence, but his uniform looked neatly pressed, with the exception of a small white stain on his left boot. It surprised Rogers, not because the stain was there, but because Rogers normally would have never noticed it. This officer thing was really starting to get to him. Soon he'd be measuring his underwear to make sure they were folded 4 inches across, or at least ordering an enlisted member to measure it. "Well then," Rogers said, by way of expressing his complete lack of ideas about what to do.
"I present to you the Artificial Intelligence Ground Combat Squadron," said the corporal,
his flat face and very out-of-style mustache turning up into a proud grin. What? The corporal, surprisingly, looked as though Roger's confusion pleased him.
"I said, I present to you the Artificial Intelligence Ground Combat Squadron."
Great. They'd transferred someone from the Public Transportation Announcer Corps to be his second in command. A PTAC was all he needed. Roger sighed. "What's wrong with your voice, Corporal?" The corporal looked indignant.
"There's nothing wrong with my voice, sir," he said,
his speech surprisingly intelligible all of a sudden. "So why are you talking like you've stolen all the marshmallows and had nowhere else to hide them?"
"It's my Thelicosan accent, sir. I'm training to be a spy. Can't be a spy if you don't sound like the Thelis, can you? I practice all day."
He cleared his throat.
"I means, I practice all of the days."
The Thelicosans are the neighboring system, who are very bellicose. Bellicose Thelicosa. The corporal's speech degenerated into something that Rogers was nearly positive had no vowels in it. What? Corporal Albert Tunger, sir. You see how good I've gotten? I can barely understand myself sometimes. I'm sure you're the envy of the intelligence squadron, Rogers said. I'm assuming you're my second in command here?
No, the corporal
said.
I'm your orderly.
My what? Your orderly? I'm here to tackle the administrative tasks that officers are generally too busy or too lazy to do. Right, Rogers said. Well, the first thing I want you to do as my orderly is ditch that accent. I can't work with someone that sounds like he's always puckering up for a kiss. Not that he wanted to do any actual work. He really just didn't want to listen to Tunger talk.
But,
Tunger whined, his face sagging, I'm training to be a spy. How am I going to be a spy if I sound like your everyday Meriden man? They'll shoot me the first time I open my mouth. I'm considering shooting you right now. You can practice when we're not in here doing, droid stuff, okay? There are plenty of other people to talk to on this ship other than me.
Okay,
Tunger said, hanging his head. Rogers sat down in the only chair in the room, which was pushed up next to a computer terminal, and put his feet up. He tried to adopt a position of nonchalance and comfort, but with his uniform tailored to actually look good when worn, it was a difficult task. It always felt like his shirt and trousers were having a war over his underwear, and had reached a stalemate. Now, Rogers said, pulling at his crotch to no effect, if you're not my second, who is? One of the droids, front and center in the 5x7 formation, stepped forward, his metal feet making much less noise on the floor than Rogers was used to hearing. Rogers saw why. The combat droid's legs had a series of shock absorbers that ran from their hip joints down to their ankles, and their four-clawed feet sported some sort of soft rubber on the bottom. Rogers wasn't sure which he preferred, a droid he could hear coming an astronomical unit away, or a droid that he didn't know was there until they rubbed noses. I am Cyberman First Class, FGC-001, the droid said. I am second in command of the 331st Eggs. Rogers noticed he pronounced it like eggs, in typical Ramrod military acronym style, though he wasn't sure where the C had gone. Hey, Rogers said, you don't sound like a moron. To fill in some context here, all the other droids in the story so far, they speak in functions. So they walk up to him and they say, call function, say hello, output string, hello. And this particular droid doesn't sound like a moron. Hey, Rogers said, you don't sound like a moron.
Oh, sure, Corporal Tunger said. He can talk any way he wants.
He abruptly turned away and folded his arms, staring at the wall.
Droids can't be spies.
I must request clarification for this statement. The droid, Rogers decided to call him O-1, said. I mean, you're not calling functions or calculating pi in the middle of a sentence or anything. Tunger, apparently over his short burst of teenage angst, turned around and pointed a finger in the air as he lectured.
New models. They've got the F-chip.
What's that?
Freudian chip, named after a famous old psychologist. This is the first batch of prototype units with it. It adds a bit of human rationality and psyche, and apparently helps with their combat reactions. The first batch of egg units spent most of their time comparing casualty calculations, and tended to go with solutions that left one guy alive on the side that was supposed to win.
Tunger shrugged.
Boolean logic has its limits, I guess.
Rogers angled his desk chair slightly toward O-1. So, you're an F-chip droid. A Freud. You are correct, though the word Freud does not appear in my vocabulary. Install it, Rogers said, because that's what I'm going to call you new models. He leaned forward. You don't, like, feel or anything, do you? If you are asking whether or not an F-chip droid... The droid made an unintelligible computation noise that sounded a little like an old skipping record. If you are asking whether or not Freuds have human emotions, you are correct in your assumption that we do not feel. That's great, Rogers said. He thought back to the way the inspection droid had reacted when he used the word shinies. Rogers could have sworn that it had gotten angry, which just seemed ridiculous. I don't think I could handle it if any of you started crying or trying to tell jokes or anything like that.
I have no reserves of saline solution to excrete from my ocular implants, the droid said. If this is a modification that is desired, please see Ensign McSchmidt in the engineering bay, who will put in a request for a new design.
I think we'll skip it, Rogers said, but thanks for the suggestion.
Rogers sat in silence for a moment, O-1 staring at him with that blank, blue-eyed gaze, and Tunger looking a little depressed at not being able to talk like an idiot. A droid as his deputy, wonderful. Judging from the rest of the people he'd met on the flagship so far, he wasn't sure that many of the human choices were any better. Briefly, he thought about simply leaving, blowing off the training altogether and going to find a good card game to join, but that didn't seem practical. He didn't think he could find a card game in the entire battle group, for one, and that wasn't being quite subtle enough about doing a poor job. If he was going to be bad at something, he couldn't make it look like he was trying to be bad at it. So, he did something just short of being overtly stupid. He put a corporal in charge.
Tunger, he said, you've got control. Why don't you give me a little demonstration of what these battle bots can do?
The corporal stiffened.
That's not really my job, sir. I'm here to help you with the administration and organization.
Come on, Roger said. Show me the good stuff. Make them spin around in circles and shoot each other with paint guns and do karate.
The word karate does not appear in my vocabulary, O-1 said. Are you referring to droid foo?
Shut up for right now. I'm trying to get the corporal to do orderly stuff, like order you around with orders. Tunger?
Tunger's face was getting red, and he was avoiding meeting Roger's gaze.
It's just that...
You have no idea how they work, do you? Tunger looked at the floor.
No.
Roger sighed and stood up. How long have you worked with droids?
Since I was transferred from the zoo deck.
Well, that explains the boot stain, Rogers thought.
And that was?
The corporal hesitated.
3 days ago?
Rogers grit his teeth. Another bizarre personnel transfer. What would possess Admiral Klein to put a zookeeper, if Tunger had even been in that illustrious of a position on the zoo deck, with droids? Rogers supposed dealing with strange creatures might give Tunger a leg up, but Rogers didn't think these shinies would respond to fish or whistles. Maybe electrical prods, though.
Fine, fine. Did they tell you anything at all about these droids before you came here?
Tunger brightened and turned to where a small cabinet was attached to the wall. He opened it with his personal keycard and removed a strange-looking datapad, roughly twice as large as the standard-issue personal datapad that everyone was required to use. He handed it to Rogers with ceremonial seriousness.
They told me about this, sir,
Tunger said.
It's the control pad. I tried to play with it a little, but it's not keyed to me. You'll have to unlock it with your keycard first.
Rogers held the device as though it was a live grenade with the pin pulled out. In his hands, he held the controls for a bunch of shinies, none of whom had any personalities, but all of whom had weapons, and he was supposed to somehow train them to fight. Or were they supposed to train him instead? Removing his keycard from the back of his data pad, he swiped it in the slot on the side of the control pad. The formerly blank screen lit up, and it was a few moments before a complicated control panel came onto the screen. Nothing on it was marked at all, and there was precious little to distinguish one button from the other. Small green and red squares dotted the display, looking almost like a new sort of game or an old box of chewing gum. And there was one large orange square button at the bottom.
Well, this is helpful, Rogers said. Is there an instruction manual of any sort?
Yes,
Tunger said excitedly, happy to be of use.
Yes, there is.
He reached around to the same cabinet and pulled out a sheet of laminated plastic paper and handed it over.
Ah, Rogers said. Well, let's see then.
It was a picture of the datapad with all the buttons on it. Nothing was labeled.
What the hell am I supposed to do with this? Rogers asked.
Tunger's smile faded.
Well, I think they might have thought you would label them as, you know, you figured them out?
Roger shook his head.
All right, O-1, what about you? If I get blasted by these phantom thelicosans that everyone keeps talking about, what happens?
I assume command of the eggs and utilize the best available strategy to neutralize the threat at hand.
About as descriptive as the command pad, thanks. Anything more than that? How exactly do you exert said command?
I utilize the best available strategy to neutralize the threat at hand.
Rogers ran his hands down his face, grabbing onto his beard and pulling hard.
I think I'd rather have another inspection.
For inspections, you should contact the Standardization and Evaluation Squadron. I am not programmed for that function. Thankfully not. Rogers turned the command pad over in his hands, wondering what would happen if he just started pushing buttons. The big one on the bottom, the orange square, looked promising, but maybe it was an execution command that only made any sense to use after other commands had been issued. It all seemed like a very primitive system for such advanced technology. Well, Rogers said, here goes nothing. Why don't you step back into formation, O-1? The droid's eyes flashed for a moment. I am unable to find a suitable answer for that question. Most likely it is because I have not been ordered to do so by my superior officer. Rogers blinked. Get back in formation. Yes, sir. The droid moved smoothly back to the position it had occupied previously. Taking up the pad in his hand and swiping the keycard again, it had locked itself in the interim minutes. He hovered his finger over the orange button, wondering, what if it was the seek and destroy button, or the fire indiscriminately button, or worse, the talk to your commander button? He had to believe that whoever had designed these things wouldn't let something so dangerous be so easy to do. He pressed the button, muscles tense. A resounding ding came from the control pad, followed by the feminine voice that seemed to come standard with all pieces of military technology. Congratulations on activating the Mark III Artificial Intelligence Ground Combat Control Pad. As thanks for activating this service, you are entitled to one free It's a Droid's Life coloring book, to be redeemed at any of the many Snaggardeer Sundries locations available across the galaxy. Remember, whatever you need, you can snag it at Snaggardeer's. Great, Rogers muttered. My life's treasure at long last. O-1 beeped, though to Rogers' eyes it hadn't done anything. Looking back down at the data pad, he found that it had locked again. Damn it. He swiped his key card again and the scream came back on. Nothing had changed. He pressed the orange button one more time. Command? The control pad prompted. Ah, here we go, Rogers said. Now we're getting somewhere. Invalid command, the control pad answered. I haven't commanded anything yet. Invalid command. Hold your horses, I'm thinking. I have received your command, O-1 said, loud enough to make Rogers jump, but I cannot execute it due to a lack of equine life forms in the immediate area. Rogers goggled at O-1, wondering what kind of witless moron had programmed these things. When he turned back to the command pad, the screen was blank. It had locked itself in the short interim. What is wrong with this thing? Rogers said as he aggressively swiped his key card through the reader, unlocking the pad once again. He tapped the orange button. Command? Disable the auto-lock feature on the command pad. Security protocol prevents users from tampering with access features on this command pad. Command? Ugh, Rogers said. What was he supposed to do with these droids anyway? He didn't know how to fight himself, so it seemed kind of ridiculous to try and teach them how to do it. Maybe some of that standard Steuben-esque drill maneuver crap would suffice for now. It was about the only military training that Rogers remembered other than engineering work. Stand at attention, he barked. Command received. None of the droids moved, but Tunger's boots clicked together so hard that Rogers thought he might sprain his ankle. Not you. Oh, Tunger said, his face turning sour. I don't get to do anything either? You're supposed to keep things orderly, Rogers said, so do that. Surprisingly, this seemed to please Tunger. Yes, sir, he said, and, for some reason, left the room. Turning back to the droids, he noticed that none of them seemed to have changed position. But now that he thought of it, it was the same position they'd been in the entire time. Was this standing at attention? O-1, Rogers said. Why did none of you do anything, even though this thingy here said that the command was received? We are unable to find location attention at which to stand. What? It's a military drill term. Maybe they just couldn't stand at attention because it just didn't work with their metallic bodies. Maybe he could get him to move around a little. He ripped his key card so hard through the reader that it didn't have time to recognize his credentials, forcing him to do it again. Unlock, screen up, orange button, command. Right face, Rogers barked, astonished at his own drill sergeantness. That did something. The entire group of droids, in one frighteningly smooth and coordinated motion, pivoted and snapped their bodies 90 degrees to the right, bringing their legs down with much less noise than a group of shinies should have made with all their stomping around. Now we're talking, he said. What are we talking about? Tunger said as he came into the room with a small dustpan and broom and began sweeping up. What are you doing?
Keeping things orderly, sir.
Right, Roger said, turning back to the command pad and pressing the orange... Unlocking the worthless piece of shit with his goddamn keycard and pressing the orange button. March!
For commands to be executed at a later date, please specify the day and year as well.
No, Rogers cried. Not March the month. March forward!
Vibrations coursed through the floor of the training room as the entire formation of droids ran into the wall that was 6 feet in front of them. As they collided with the wall, they kept moving forward, their legs pumping up and down, though they seemed to be doing little enough damage to each other in the process. Perhaps it was a benefit of their made-for-combat metal alloy or whatever.
Stop! Rogers shouted. Why are you doing that?
We are responding to the command given, O-1 said, though the voice was muffled by his speech transmitter being smashed up against the wall.
Oh, for the love of... March backward, will you?
Affirmative. The formation marched backward until they were in the middle of the room again, at which point Rogers shouted for them to stop. They didn't stop. Looking down at the control pad, he noticed that it was probably because it was locked. Rogers took it in his hand, about to throw it at Tunger's broom, but was distracted by the clattering of a formation of droids hitting the opposite wall.
Stop! Rogers shouted at the command pad once he'd unlocked it again.
The formation of droids stopped abruptly, the sudden silence almost as startling as the symphony of metal had been moments earlier.
Dear God, Rogers said. What use is this?
We are used to neutralize the current threat by utilizing the best...
Shut up! Rogers said.
He took a deep breath. Okay, so moving them wasn't as easy as he thought. He definitely wasn't ready to try anything with weapons yet, that was for sure. Not that he really wanted to. Maybe he could march them down the hallway and accidentally vent the room to open space or something. No, too obvious. God, he wanted a drink.
Everyone stand still and do nothing, he said.
Everyone stood still and did nothing, and he counted this as a minor victory. Perhaps simply changing formation types would work. If they were supposed to go to combat, surely they knew things like wedges, columns, staggered lines, and all that, right? At least that's what they did in the movies. Rogers wasn't exactly a resident expert on combat. All right, he said. All right. Let's see. Swiping his keycard. He was going to have a copy made and permanently glued to this damn machine. He pressed the command button. What were those other little green squares for?
Command? Form a column.
The droids snapped into action immediately, and Rogers stepped back with a satisfied grin as the whole orchestra started to play the same tune with Rogers on the conductor's stand. Despite his feelings about droids, he couldn't help but feel a little bit of pride as the droids starting smoothly interchanging positions, not running into anything at all, and tearing the metal panels off the walls.
What the hell are you doing? Rogers cried. Stop!
The inert command pad didn't help him since it had locked itself again. Slamming his card through the reader, he was greeted only with a crudely drawn, not rendered like regular graphics, but drawn as though by a 5-year-old, picture of a battery with a line through it. It was out of charge.
Tunger, Rogers shouted. This is all your fault.
My fault?
This isn't very orderly at all. The damn thing is out of batteries.
The droids, in the meantime, had convened in the center of the training room, bringing with them pieces of the walls, exposing part of the vast network of pipes, wires, cables, and whatever else made up the guts of the flagship. Arms flashing in silver-gray blurs, they extended and retracted, the droids' legs telescopically reaching higher until they were at the ceiling. In moments, a crudely but solidly crafted shaft of metal ran from floor to ceiling in the center of the room, like one of those senseless metal sculptures in backwater museums.
What have you done? Rogers cried once the noise settled down. You've ruined the training room.
We have formed a column, sir, O-1 said, utilizing the best available strategy. Rogers stared blankly at the almost certainly laughing eyes of the Freud, wondering if they could do things out of spite, wondering if this was all a joke, and Magistrate Tuckall was about to burst through the door red-faced with laughter and tell him that the awesome had been repaired and he could go on his merry way. But that didn't happen. Instead, the eggs stood around their newly formed monument of stupidity, looking at Rogers to give them their next command.
Low battery, chirped the command pad.
Rogers looked at the command pad, looked at the tangled mass of metal, and looked at Tunger.
Charge this, he said, throwing it at Tunger,
who caught it and saluted with a snap. And get me an instruction manual. I'm going to go eat a sewer rat. That's the name of their rations. The presence of rodents, while a viable food source, is unlikely in this ship's waste disposal system, sir, O-1 offered helpfully. It is unlikely that you will find a sewer rat to eat.
I'll use the best available strategy and see what happens, Rogers said, and left.
And that's a chapter out of Mechanical Failure. God, that was a long read. Are you all still here? It's weird doing this in front of nobody in front of me. So there it is. There's one chapter of the goofy first book of the Epic Failure Trilogy, Mechanical Failure. So screw it, let's give the whole trilogy away again. Alex, start a new giveaway for a trilogy! Ah! And let's start the music again.